give us a note from Igalo, where we were leading product, and a note from him also from the product cat community in Berlin, where you are also.
There and it was a fantastic time. I really learned a lot about product while I was over there. And what I'm trying to communicate today is not that much about, you know, how do you do a specific user test or something like that, but what I believe is much more in the big picture about how to start a company and how to get involved and how to go about that. And I can give you all the details about the four startups that I've done, and I can give you a lot of shit about Idealo, what I've seen there when you have 200 engineers and when you have management that tells you that they need that feature that they wanted for 3 years ago, they still couldn't get it done, and now they have a chief product officer and he would get it done for them. And it's full of shit. But I did this for 4 years and I really believe that we moved Idealo from a very somewhat chaotic without any product management phase to a really organized, process-oriented company that maintains a fantastic franchise, that maintains something that's really valuable, that has 40 million sessions a month. But anyhow, I don't want to talk about EDR, I want to talk about my new venture, and that takes us as an example how you could start something if you really get passionate about that. And I call this bootstrap. And if you ever thought about what actually bootstrap means, it means that you take the lace off your shoes and pull yourself over a wall, which literally is impossible. So starting something is literally impossible, and only crazy people sometimes start new companies because they get really passionate about an idea, they really believe they can solve a problem, and that's, I think, is a starting point. So I'm not that much into methodologies. I believe that methods and methodologies are very important, I believe tools are very important, but it always starts with people and ideas. And I want to tell you what we have done. So, when you ever have an idea, what are you going to do? You're going to start talking to your friends, you're going to talk to other people, you try to validate this idea. That's absolutely nothing with a prototype. This is really comes for 3 or 6 months, maybe 2 years before you actually even start actually working on it. This idea starts growing. It's a little seed that starts growing in your mind, and then it starts becoming something interesting, and as it becomes more interesting, you do more research about it, and you talk with more people, and at some point you basically don't want to take the jump, you don't want to take a plunge into this thing and actually do that. And what I believe is that 9 out of 10 ideas never get to that stage. And then from the remaining ideas, 9 out of 10 of those ideas, people are just too afraid to actually do that. They're saying, it would have been great if I would have done that, but you know, it doesn't work anyway. So the reality is if you do a startup, there's a big chance that you fail. I listened to Silicon Valley. Every venture capital guy who was here at Santa will tell you 9 out of 10 companies fail. And the funny thing is, they want them to fail, and they want them to fail quick. The worst that can happen is that you not fail, but you're not successful. You come somewhere in this middle ground where it's kind of grayish. You make a little revenue, you have some customer, kind of looks promising, and you believe that maybe next year, whatever, they want you to fail fast. So learn fast, fail fast. But that's what happens with ideas. So when you say 1 out of 10 and then 1 out of 10, you say what 1 idea out of 100 actually will make it to something meaningful. And you have to deal with that. So I actually had an idea. And I was doing exactly that. I was calling my friend and said, what do you think about that? And he talked about New Zealand football, and I said, no, I don't want to do New Zealand football. That's not my idea. But my idea is different. My idea is that television sucks. Who would agree with that? 50%, maybe more.
What is it?
Why is that?
And what is it?
What is television? Television is a thing that, okay. people in average watch 220 minutes a day television in Germany. So it's something that comes along the cable. Some people know you use streaming, but people watch television because they like to get entertained, they like to get informed. And when you go way back to this stage here, television was about living the real world into your living room. But now we can do streaming, we can do television everywhere we are, we can do it in the S-Bahn, the U-Bahn, whatever. Still, television sucks today. It's either commercials, it's bad programming, talk about reality TV, or it's something that runs at 11 o'clock at night when you maybe asleep. So we said, no, television isn't that bad. There are actually fantastic programs out there, but they're fucking hard to find. There's the thing about Edward Snowden, which is Citizen 4, or there's the thing about the Hubble telescope. And when you see the thing, that I just didn't know. It's fantastic education about science. Or there's something about nature. There's something about the Galapagos Islands, or New Zealand. There's great nature documentaries every day on TV, but you don't know even if they exist. You don't even look for them because you don't know what you're searching for. And there's adventure. There's fantastic programming, for instance, from that point TV that shows you or some crazy guys go down this canyon for 5 or 6 days and risk their life and have an experience like Marzer. And do you want to watch that? Of course you want, because that's good television. And there's more, because there's arts and there's culture. There's this ballet in London, and you may be into ballet or not, I actually personally love ballet. And that's the greatest ballet I've ever seen in my life. And you see, Jesus, there's so much great programming. There must be something that we can do about that. So everybody that is interested in great television can actually see it. And that's the problem that we want to do. So now you have a problem is feeling like I talked to 50 people and at least 30 people are saying, yeah, television sucks. I still switch it on, I go to my 27 channels, and after 10 minutes I switch it off saying this really sucks. Some people don't even have cable anymore, especially the younger people. They've cut the cord and say, what the fuck, I watch Netflix, I watch Amazon, I watch Hulu, or whatever they do, but they do all the entertaining programming. We don't do that. So we look at some ingredients to get started, and it starts with creating a big vision. And the big vision goes back to the start, where you're saying, well, I have an idea, now I have to get a vision. But on a vision, I don't even know where I'm going to go. At EDL, I call it this product north. Product north for me is basically putting a big vision up there and saying, like North Pole, there I want to get to. And when you create a big vision and you're in Berlin, and whatever you do, you can always say, is that helping you to get further north? And if it doesn't help you to get further north, you just don't do that. Like Barford wouldn't get me further north. I mean, don't get me wrong, but I love Barford. But Barford is a tax company, you might say, well, Barford goes maybe east or west or maybe even south. Right now you would say, well, look, this house, you know, it costs me 3 weeks. So if you create a vision, you actually put something up and say, this is where I want to go. The great thing is everyone in the company understands we want to get to the North Pole. Not tomorrow, but generally speaking, that's the direction we want to have. So a big vision is really important. And what we do is we say, well, simply, we want to make television smarter. We want to make it simple, we want it smarter, and we want to do this by creating a system that provides the best national and international documentaries or non-fiction content in the carries politics, culture, and science. And when we combine them in one app, that's very easy to use. We said, well, we want to do that. Let's get to work. And when you get to work, the first thing you need is good people. No, you need great people. You need people that actually love that vision, that are willing to spend their fucking weekends and spend their evenings and spend every day, every minute of their life saying, how can we accomplish that vision eventually that we get to the North Pole, and in this regard, to get to something that is a service for lots of people. And you look for talent, you look for skills, you look for expertise, and very important, you look for trust. You have to trust these people, and they have to trust you. So it has nothing to do with how we do business model canvas and all these methodologies. Really, it's way before you can get to writing one line of code, you have to get together and feel like this is what we want to do. Because it's not going to take a week, or not 3 weeks, or not 4 weeks, it's going to take you 5 years. Because it's a big thing. If you start a company, I've started four, yeah, I want to do this iterative, be very good about that. But I still have to have a big vision. Otherwise, I get a Kerberos station. I don't need a big vision for a Kerberos station, I just need a great location. But what we do in technology, we want to change people's lives, we want to solve big problems, so you need great people now to do that. So there's Marlo, which is my goddess of product. There's Heiko, who does everything to make sure that I can work. There's Leo, who does all the server shit, and there's myself. The next thing, what you need is lots of passion. You need to really want to solve that problem. If you don't have that passion, latest after 6 months, you're saying, what, I'm spending every weekend here, I don't go out with my friends, my wife or my partner is complaining that I never have time for him or her, whatever. So the passion, I think, is very important for this project because you will need that when things are tough. And then when you've solved all these things, you may start building. And building is important because in building, you need tools and you need methods. And yes, it's people, methods, tools. The great thing about starting today, not starting 20 years ago, where I started a company, you had to do everything by yourself. You had a server admin, you had a network admin for your work, you had a network in the office, there was nothing. There was no fucking framework, there was just nothing there. You had to do everything. Today, Slack is free, GitHub costs you $10, Atlassian Cloud costs you $9. So basically for $20 you get all your operational tools that you need in order to work effectively, efficiently. The same is true for your operation expenses. The only server you should have in your office is the espresso machine. That's actually important. We use Firebase, which is a great key value store, which is a real-time database. We use lots of Amazon services. We use Netlify, which is a great service for JavaScript applications that do Jamstack applications. Netlify costs us $9 a month. And we host a system that has more than 20,000 active users. Firebase costs us $50 a month. For Amazon, right now, we pay roughly $500. So for a system that's now operational with a fair amount of users, we spend less than $1,000 a month. That is the need. And you have to think like that. Everybody is saying, I need a server in my room, should not do a server. And last but not least, I think you have to learn the skills. Every startup that requires outside work from expensive consultants is in my mind, will fail. These lots of consultants will take the money, and when the money is gone, they say, well, you have to give me more money in order to do the next iteration. So it's very hard to do that. You have to get people on board. That's why the people in the beginning are important, that are willing to do it themselves on their own money, more or less, and then they use generally the tools that everybody's using, and they're demos, they're very powerful. There's obviously lots of online tutorials like Code School, which we have used extensively. There's Angular, which is a great framework, or Bootstrap for responsive web design, there's Swift for iOS. But surround yourself with stuff that you learn to use. Because then if you can't use it yourself, then you rely on people that don't have the passion that you bring in order to make this project successful. So having good technical people and good product people on your team, I believe, is very important. Very early and very often, build prototypes. Let me give you one example. Like every web service or every website, we want to be findable in search engines. So in order to be findable in search engines, you need content that you have, that nobody else has. In order to be able to you need content, you need content management system because somebody has to put the content in there and it has to be hosted. So what did we do in order to do that? Said, well, we have people that write the content, they just write in a JSON, in a JSON file, and we load the JSON file and publish the content on the website. That's not a content management system, it was good enough to publish 100 pages, and it cost us zero development. It was 4 hours to just write, read the JSON file, and then publish the static pages. So finding ways to get things done in a prototype way, because we didn't know if that particular landing page that we built would ever be found by the Google index. So trying to find ways, which is very similar to what you said, finding ways to get things done at a minimalistic technology way is a prudent thing to do. Because in the old way, people have said, well, oh, let's bring a content management system on board. Then you do like a 6-week evaluation of 23 different content management systems, you implement things in 6 weeks, and then after 6 months, you may have the first landing page. To get the first landing page, took us a day. Right? And then you put in the index and said, well, did anything happen? No. Okay, then you start putting money on it, with AdWords and so forth. But having this attitude of taking, always challenging yourself to what you were saying, how can we do this the cheapest way? One of the things that Mao and I do all the time is we use t-shirt sizes. So we have lots of eventually things that we want to get done. Typically they're based on objectives we are setting. And then we put t-shirt sizes on it, which is extra small, small, medium, large. And when she said, well, this is the thing, I'm saying, well, it's large, I'm not going to do it. Make it smaller. So it's this kind of attitude where you're saying, well, if you want to innovative in engineering, you have to work with small and medium tasks that you can understand and assess easy. Eventually, you have to break it down. And yes, things take time. It took us about from the summer 2014, which was we had an idea, to the spring of 2016, so roughly a year and a half from this is an idea to something that we actually presented publicly. There's lots of iteration between, lots of testing between. We had, after 3 months, we had a website that we could present. We showed people. It's in the end, it's a complex system. It's not that simple. We do crawling of libraries, of online libraries. We have to get the crawler fixed. We have a content management system for our editorial process. We build a web app because everybody has a browser. After the web app, we build an iOS app because iOS is a premium product with iPad for media. So we start relatively small, but in the end, to say this is a version, we say this is now complete, took us essentially a good year and a half, and now we spent the next year to do bootstrapping. So where we are today, we have roughly 50 to 20,000 active users per month, and we're now moving into the next two phases, which is market fit and monetization. Market fit, so we basically do what the Valley is doing, it's build, grow, monetize. You build something, you innovate, until you feel like this is not good enough so I can start growing. So scaling basically the whole system, we're trying to get to 250 to 500,000 users by the end of the year and have some partners in order to do that. And then we go into monetization next year. So break it down, understand your milestones. We had at least one, this was basically what we had about a year ago. We have at least two that we have now, and well, that's kind of what we do. So this is part expected. What I want to communicate is really, when you get to this point where you actually have something you feel is valuable, then you start spending money. At some point, bootstrapping has its limits, right? Because at some point, you're not fast enough, you don't have money to execute marketing campaigns and so forth. So when you get to this growth phase, you have to figure out how do you do that? Because you need helping hands, you need more than the 3 or 4 or 5 guys that actually have work the nights and the evenings and the weekends. So you need adverts, you need Facebook, you need social, you need more helping hands like interns and what have you. You use a lot of analytics to get to the data, what people are actually doing with your system and what have you. And yes, you need a lawyer. Not my favorite part, but at some point you need a corporation and you need to incorporate and you have to get contracts and you have to get partners, investors and so forth. But you don't need a lawyer on the first day. You need people you trust. And with people you trust, you don't need contracts. You just say, well, let's just do that. And so really what I wanted to communicate today is not the detail of how you work with lean startup methods in terms of particular feature development, because this was kind of more what you covered, and I could tell you the same stories and would sound very similar, but things we failed, things we learned, we do things very iterative and as small as possible, but more like what comes way before that, and the passion and the problem that you want to solve, and you have to be convinced that this is something that you do. So hopefully that inspired you a little bit. Thank you very much. Because I tried to do this in Idealo. I went to the CEO at least 6 times and saying, I have a great idea, can I do that? And he said, well, we have all these other ideas that we wanted to do 3 years ago, and now let's do those first. I said, fuck it. No, seriously. I mean, I actually said this directly to him. I said, then fuck you. Because what you need is people that are getting passionate about something and you just let them do. You just say, he should have said, look, how many people do you need? I said 3, a room, and 6 months. Mm-hmm. And he just didn't do that. And it's that simple. You can't, but on the other side, they say, by the way, I have a great idea, let's do that. Let's hire a innovation consultant. Mm-hmm. And they did this. And the problem was with this project, I call it a CEO project. The problem with CEO project is that there's no option to fail because it's a CEO project. So everybody was extremely cautious about listening what the CEO had thought about, and then, well, we get this consultant, and then they consulted for like 6 months, and then they built something that was ridiculously bad. It took 1.5 years. Instead of just saying, well, who is crazy enough to take an idea and say, give me 4 people in 6 months and I will get food. And I think that it's this type of trust, and it didn't work because he didn't trust me. And he had the ego to say, no, my idea is better than your idea. And I think that's kind of what I believe. It's with people.
So, which was not really the answer to that question. So what do companies have to do to create this atmosphere?
They have to find entrepreneurs, but they shouldn't.
The issue.
Yeah, you're right. They have to find entrepreneur type people who are willing to risk essentially their career into all and want to fail. There was a project at Google, it was called Google Wave. First heard about Google Wave. It was fantastic. And it failed miserably. And those people are heroes at Google. It's that simple. You give people the right to fail. And the reality is that Idealo, if you fail, you get fired. And because people know that, they're saying, no, I want to play it safe. And people always the way it's headed. And you need to have people who are going, I don't give a shit if you fire me, I will do it anyway. But you have to start somewhere.
Fired,
huh?
But if they didn't get fired.
Yeah, I got fired. In the end, you know, I mean, no, it's hated, but and I'm happy that they did. But I was willing to get fired.
Any more questions for Dirk?
Shocking. Really good one. I like the question.
What's your fallback option?
What's that?
What's your fallback option?
Fallback option to do what?
If you fail on your own,
you go to the next one. You know what? Fear is a bad advisor. If you start on something having fearing that you fail, you're not going to do the right decisions. If you're saying failure is an option, which I always do, you're totally cool about that. If you cannot do that, then you shouldn't start a company. And it's not a criticism. I think you need to have a certain personality and honestly say, I'm more curious to see what happens instead of I'm afraid to fail. And I'm always more curious to see what happens. I don't know if this works. Mm-hmm. But I have 20,000 people who are saying this is a cool service. And I'm feeling like about 20,000, maybe not 200,000. And I'm trying to find a way to get to the 200,000. And it's a big bet because I'm betting the last 2.5 years or it's a weekend and fair amount of money by now. At this point, it's a success. It will always be a success because we got something from a pure idea to a product. And even if we cannot monetize it, I know that some people love it, and that's fair enough. And I learned a fair amount of it in this journey. I think that's a reality in my mind.
You have already a financial model?
You sound like ABC. Sorry, that's the first question. You always get the question, how do you monetize? And I say, listen, if I get 500,000 users, I find a way to monetize. I have 4 or 5 options, and I believe we can monetize.
From that standpoint,
okay.
From the user standpoint.
From the user
standpoint. Do you pay to monthly pay or do you more on the advertisement money or what's the.
Okay, we to make what's the plan. The plan is to find out how it works. We can imagine that the premium services that the user would pay as a premium, like Spotify, where you're basically saying, well, everyone can use Spotify, but every 7 minutes is fucking advertising and you hate that, so you eventually pay in $5. There could be pay-per-view that we have exclusive content that we have because then we have 500,000 people saying I love documentaries or non-fiction. I can feed them non-fiction content that they cannot find anywhere else. So I can do it like an iTunes or like a Netflix.
But can't we use it for free?
It's currently for free.
Okay.
If you want, I can show it to you.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
You ask questions, I show you in the meantime, I show you what we're looking
for. So actually, it's for free right now. What? Hold people back actually to go for it.
To know
about it.
Yeah, we have essentially got 20,000 people with viral marketing. It's social share and what have you. And really what we do is like when it goes through all the media libraries that are available, there are roughly 25 or 30 media libraries in Germany alone. Everybody offers you 2,000 to 3,000 entries. So all this together gives you roughly 100,000 entries of available videos. And that's horrible. That's worse than 27 channels because you don't even know where to start. And what we do with an editorial staff, we curate the content. We're saying, well, we just filter everything out that's bullshit. And we just give you what we believe is the most attractive content. I was looking for a good word. Attractive content. We start with, you know, if you don't have any time to search, go to our top 5, and you get something that's very specific to what's currently happening in the world. Or you can go to one of the